Hello, welcome to Schmashupre. In this series, I'm going to show how you can build math from the ground up, starting from set theory. My plan is to be as rigorous as I can be for the rest of the series, but for this video, I'm going to be very loose and just try to build an intuition for what the sets of set theory are. So, what is a set? Here's the first attempt at an answer. A set is a collection of objects. What kinds of objects? Well, they could be just about anything. Shapes? Numbers? Whatever you want, really. Even other sets. In fact, in set theory, we're going to be interested only in sets that contain nothing but other sets, like this one here. Wait, if a set is a collection of objects, and in set theory, the objects in question are sets, that would mean that a set is a collection of sets. If you're confused by the statement, or think it even sounds paradoxical, that's because it's a meaningless piece of trash that deserves to be tossed. As I said, this was a first attempt. We'll need to look elsewhere for a true answer to the question, what is a set? Before we do that, though, let's take a step back and look at sets of regular stuff to try to get an intuition. That is, for the moment, sets are not allowed to contain other sets. Let's be concrete and say we're looking at sets of shapes. Even more concrete, we'll say that these are the only shapes we're allowed. A set, in this case, is any collection of these five shapes. For each shape, we could choose to either include it or not. I could also choose to include all of them or none of them. You could also denote sets in other ways, such as by drawing a blob surrounding the shapes that are included in the set, or by pointing out those shapes with arrows. I've connected the tail ends of the arrows at a point here for a few reasons, one of which is that it allows you to depict multiple different sets at the same time without duplicating any of the shapes, which will be useful later on. In math, we often write sets like this, where we list everything in the set, separated by commas, and surround the whole thing in a pair of curly braces. Each of these ways of denoting a set has its advantages and disadvantages. The objects that are in a set are called its elements, so here the circle, square, and star are all elements of this set, while a triangle and pentagon are not. Note that we can list them in any order, so this set is the same as this one, or this one. If we list the same element more than once, that's the same thing as listing it just once. Something is either in the set or it is not. It can't be in the set multiple times. So this set could also be written like this. We could denote the set with nothing in it as just a pair of curly braces with nothing between them, but we often instead write it as the circle with a bar through it. We call it the empty set. There are other ways of specifying a set besides listing everything it contains. For instance, we could give a property that elements must have, and consider the set of all objects with that property. For example, we could have the set of regular polygons, which in this case contains the triangle, square, and pentagon. We write it like so, read as the set of X such that X is a regular polygon. Here, X could be replaced by whatever we want, as long as it's not in use elsewhere, and we use the same name for it everywhere. This notation is called set builder notation. Okay, now let's go to something a little more complicated. Now we're going to look at sets of natural numbers, that is, whole numbers starting at zero. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and so on. Notice that there are infinitely many of these. For each number, there's a next number, which is different from all the numbers that have come before. So we're never going to be able to write down all the numbers. What sets of numbers do we have here? Well, we have finite sets, like this one, where we can list all its elements out. It contains 1, 3, 7, and nothing else. But we can also have sets with infinitely many elements, like the set of even numbers, which contains 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, and so on, but we'll never be able to list out all the elements. Or the set of all of them, which we might write in set builder notation like this, where this T is read as true and is a property that all numbers have. This is where set builder notation really comes in handy. It allows us to explicitly define many more sets than we could just by listing their elements. This is important. It's tempting to think of a set as a list of things, where you then ignore repeats and the order the elements appear in. For finite sets, this is okay, and the programmers among you might have used the word set to mean just that. But it won't work for infinite sets, where you can't list out all the elements. A set is not a list. Okay, let's go back to our five shapes from before to keep things sane. Maybe we'll even trim down to just three shapes. Because now, we're going to bring in sets that can contain other sets. But we'll only go one level of crazy. So our sets can now contain shapes and sets of shapes, but not sets of shapes, or anything beyond that. So we could have the set of all possible sets of shapes, or the set that contains just the set of the circle and triangle, as well as the set of the square. And maybe if we're really adventurous, we could have a set that contains both sets of shapes and the shapes themselves, say this one, which contains the set of the circle, the set of the triangle, and the triangle itself. Okay, things are starting to get a little confusing. Note that there's a difference between a shape and the set containing just that shape. Also, although sometimes it's nice to think of sets as containers with stuff inside, like I've been depicting them here, sets don't work exactly the same way as containers do. If you put a ball inside a bag, and put that bag inside a box, then the ball is inside the box. This isn't true for sets. This set contains the set of the circle, but it does not contain the circle itself. On the other hand, it contains the set of the triangle, and also independently contains the triangle. A set is not a container. We saw that you can also represent sets as dots with arrows pointing to all their elements. Hopefully this depiction makes sets look a little less like containers. If you have a set that contains other sets, simply draw an arrow pointing to the dots corresponding to those sets. A dot with no arrows pointing from it is the empty set. If I create another dot with an arrow pointing to the empty set, then that is the set which contains nothing but the empty set. That's two sets we can form, and we haven't even bothered including any of our shapes inside. Regardless if our starting objects are shapes, or numbers, or anything else, the empty set and the set of the empty set will always be valid sets. We could even have no starting objects. Now let's let the floodgates open and allow for sets to be as deeply nested as we want. Let's see what other sets we can build starting from nothing. Let's see, we can create a set with just the set of the empty set in it, or a set containing both of our first two sets. If we keep picking various subcollections of these sets, we can get all these new sets. But the point is, there seems to be a lot of complex structure we can get just building sets starting from nothing. And that's where the idea for set theory comes in. Maybe having other objects besides sets to play with wasn't necessary at all, and the sets you can build with no starting objects are interesting enough to be studied in their own right. So from now on, we'll assume all the sets we are talking about are built entirely from other sets, starting from nothing. We could keep building new sets in stages. At each stage, our sets are the subcollections of the sets from the previous stages. Are these all the sets that can be formed starting from nothing? Not even close. We could form the set of all sets we can form in this way. That is, it contains all sets that appear after a finite number of stages. This set is going to be infinite, but that's fine. This set lies in a new stage, and now we've got another set to pick from for creating new sets. And we could keep going up the stack, and then adding more columns, and then... Ooh, but what about the set of all sets? Whoa, slow down. That's one step too far now. Here's where we have to face reality. When we were dealing with shapes or numbers, we could specify the set of all of them with any property we wanted, being a regular polygon, being even, whatever, or even just the set of all of them. But now we have to rethink this freedom. We were thinking of a set as a collection of objects, and in our case, those objects are sets. In that case, the collection of all sets should be a set because it is a collection of sets. But that means it would have to contain itself, or it wouldn't contain all sets. Okay, so sets can contain themselves. That doesn't quite align with our intuition of sets as containers, but I already explained that sets are not containers. So maybe a set that contains itself is okay? Sure, you could allow that, but there's a deeper problem. Now that we're tentatively allowing sets to contain themselves, what about the collection of all sets that don't contain themselves? It's a collection of sets, so it should be a set. This three-pronged symbol with a bar through it means is not an element of, so this is the set of X such that X is not an element of X. The question is, does it contain itself? Well, if it did, then because all its elements are sets that do not contain themselves, and it is one of those elements, it must not contain itself. But we're assuming that it does. That can't be, so that assumption is wrong, which means that it doesn't contain itself. But then it is a set that doesn't contain itself, and since it contains all sets that don't contain themselves, it must contain itself. But we just said that it doesn't. This is a contradiction. This set cannot exist. This is known as Russell's paradox, named after Bertrand Russell, and it means we have to forbid certain collections of sets from being sets themselves. So, a set is a collection of sets, at best only works one way. In the same way as a horse is an animal, but not every animal is a horse, we could say that a set is a collection of sets, but not every collection of sets is itself a set. A set is then a very special kind of collection of sets. We sometimes call an arbitrary collection of sets a class, and a class which is not a set is called a proper class. I won't be properly defining these terms though, and will only be using them informally. This still brings us no closer to what sets actually are though. To understand the problem we've been having, and hopefully get an idea for how to fix it, let's take a detour and look at directed graphs. I promise, this is relevant. A directed graph is a collection of nodes, and arrows between those nodes. I've drawn only finitely many of each, but in principle, a directed graph could have infinitely many nodes and arrows. We only care about whether or not two nodes are connected by an arrow, and in which direction the arrow points, not where the nodes are placed, or how the arrows are drawn. We also won't allow multiple arrows connecting two nodes in the same direction. In this directed graph, I have an arrow that points from a node to itself. I also have a pair of arrows between two nodes, pointing in opposite directions. Whether you choose to allow these in the definition of a directed graph or not won't end up mattering much for our discussion here, since we're about to rule out these cases for the graphs we're interested in anyway. The problem with our previous attempt to define sets is that sets aren't that interesting on their own. What's interesting is how they relate to other sets, namely which sets are their elements. Trying to define what a set is individually is like trying to define a node without first defining a graph. You might end up with something like, a node is something with arrows that point to other nodes, which is self-referential and not really elucidating. You can't include node in the definition of a node. Sets are similarly part of a network, and what's interesting about them is how the network is structured. In fact, directed graphs are exactly what we need to represent this network of sets. Maybe you can already see how. Each set corresponds to a node in the graph, and whenever one set is an element of another, we draw an arrow between them, with the arrow pointing from sets to their elements. Looking familiar yet? There are a lot of directed graphs out there, and most, like this one we saw earlier, won't represent sets. So what makes a directed graph a graph of sets? Obviously it would have to be infinite, because there are infinitely many sets, so I can't just draw it out for you. But maybe we can come up with a list of rules that any graph which hopes to represent the network of sets must obey. For instance, we know that there should be a node with no outgoing arrows. This corresponds to the empty set. In fact, given any finite collection of nodes, there should be one node with outgoing arrows to exactly those nodes, which corresponds to the set with precisely those sets as its elements. We'll also ask that there are no loops, so there's no way of following arrows starting at one node and getting back to where you started. This rules out sets that contain themselves and such. I could keep listing rules, but this video is already getting quite long. It suffices to say, it is certainly possible to create such a list of rules, and I will provide the full list another time. But I still want to mention two caveats. First, let's say we specified our rules. How will we know that there is a graph that satisfies those rules, and that our rules don't contradict each other? A short answer is, we won't. At some point, I may make a video that goes into more detail. But for now, we'll just choose not to worry about this. Second, how do we know there won't be multiple graphs which satisfy all the rules? Actually, we expect there to be lots of graphs that could work, but they'll be similar enough that the differences won't really matter much for our purposes. In summary, we began with a question, what is a set? We saw that, intuitively, a set is a collection of objects, which works as an intuitive definition of a set as long as we don't allow sets to contain other sets, or if we at least limit how deeply sets can be nested within each other. We saw a few things that sets are not. A set is not a list, and a set is not a container. We also saw how the definition of sets as collections of objects fails when the objects in question are sets themselves, in the form of Russell's paradox. Finally, we saw that the question we should be asking isn't what is a set, but rather how is the network of sets structured? Specifically, which directed graphs correspond to a network of sets? But answering that is going to have to wait for a couple of videos down the line. In the next video, we'll talk about logic. That'll give us the language we need to define the precise rules that our network of sets must obey. See you then!